because we were out work, we worked together, we were out at work, we're working on this like 5-story apartment complex, me and him. We're messing around with this ladder, trying to move this ladder. It ended up falling over and hitting Jack in the face. So he was having a bad day, so he got a black eye with it. But then we went up on the roof directly after that. And we were trying to steer this ladder for these young guys down there, you know, that were moving this big heavy ladder. And so we climbed up on this peak of this roof, right? And we're branded 5 stories up in the air. And so I'm at the edge of this roof. There's 12 inches on this roof that we can stand on. Jack's right here, and I'm right here. And then he steps down and starts walking down to try to tie the rope off. About that time, I hear him scream and stay out looking and starts taking off running. I said, "Oh Lord, what is going on here?" He's like, "I got stung."
Oh,
and
no.
So about that time, I'm looking around, and there's like 12, I think 10 or 12, like hornets buzzing around me. And so I have 6-story drop behind me, and hornets in the front of me. I'm trying to make a decision. Which one seems better? Go see Jesus or go to the ER?
Or my
son. I'm standing here like this, like got my hat off my head, ready to fight.
Oh God.
But thank God they didn't come after me. So I ended up running down and I jumped down off the thing once they went back into their eye. And I took off running and they chased me for a little while. But yeah, luckily Jesus is with us today and that day, and he's with us every day. So he definitely saved us. Jack was having a little worse day than I was, of course, but we still love him. Jesus loves him. And, so now we're going to get into the Word a little bit. Now I want to ask you guys a question. What do you think we learned at the fall of man when Adam took a bite of that fruit, that forbidden fruit? What we learned is self-consciousness. Self-consciousness and self are usually what we can stem most sins that we see today off of. Now, I know that when I was growing up, when I was young, I needed to feel loved and I needed to feel attention. I needed to feel affirmed by somebody else. I needed you to like me for me to like myself. And the thing is that's not necessary, because Jesus loved you. And how do we know that God loved us so much? It's because he sent his son. He sent his son to die on the cross so that we could be brought back into fellowship with the Father. This is something that we were created to be. We were created to be in fellowship with the Father, to be in love, to walk in the glory of God. And all Jesus did when he came down was to restore that relationship. So this not feeling worthy and not even liking ourselves, that's something that we didn't learn from Jesus. When we feel anxiety and we feel, you know, upset with somebody else, or you're angry with a friend, let me ask you a question. Could you see Jesus coming down here and saying, "You know what, I just don't like these people. I keep ministering to them, I heal them sick. I'm just doing everything I can for them, and Father, they just don't like me. Peter, please minister to me. Please lay your hands on me. Touch me and make me feel loved and appreciated." Can you guys see Jesus saying that? If it won't fit in Jesus' mouth, it should never fit in ours.
Amen. Say it again, brother.
Yeah. So, Jesus went to the cross to reestablish his relationship with the Father. He went to the cross so that he could bring us back into union with the Father. So, this union is a change inside of us. Heaven is not, well, let me say it this way. We don't say a prayer just to go to heaven.
Amen.
I don't know about you, but I know that with Jesus inside of me, I know that heaven comes to me. So, with Jesus inside of me, I know that I can live a changed life. A new life. A new creation. That's what he asked you to be. He asked you to be a new creation. He says that we are called to shine as a light. We're called to wake up every day and shine. We're called to love. We're called to act exactly as he acted and do the things that Jesus did. But the problem is we're so wrapped up in ourselves a lot of times that we can't even have Jesus use us for anything. Because we're half in and half out of what we're supposed to be doing. We wake up every day trying to make our life more convenient. Or what is God going to do for me today? It's not about that, guys. So I'm going to go into a little bit of scripture real quick. So the scripture I'm coming out of today is Luke 11, and it's going to be verse 33. So it says, "No one lights a lamp and then hides it, or puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand, where it can be seen by all who enter the house." We are the light. Jesus is the light. Jesus lives inside of us. And he lives inside of me, he lives inside of you, he loves you, you're forgiven, I'm forgiven. We can stand in that, we can understand that. And if we can tweak our eye to that understanding, to knowing what that means to truly be a son. If you truly know what that means to be a son or a daughter of God, then you can start living that. It's not everything that you can do. It's not what you can do to make your life better. It's not what you can do to please God. The fact is that you have to stay focused on Jesus enough to where your mind is changed, your heart is changed, and you are able to just be in love with him. That's all it comes down to, love. So it says that instead of the lamp is placed on the stand where everybody can see it, it's in the house. So when we are called to light, we're called to shine for Jesus every single day. So we're called to wake up and be like, "Lord, I thank you today that I can shine for you, that I can just work through as many people as I can, Lord, that they can see the gospel in my life, that they can be transformed by the renewing of their minds based on what they see through you coming through me." The gospel is not situational. Christian, for you, you're deceived. If you're being a Christian so that your day can be better, so that you can be in a better situation, if you're into Christianity or you want to use God as a vending machine, you're sorely deceived. Because what you're doing is you're keeping self alive. And what we are called to do is to die to ourselves. Not partially, but completely. We're called to die to ourselves. And how we die to ourselves is we thank God that we can believe in him and we can believe in the fact that he sanctified us through his blood. Matthew 16:24 says it best. It says, "You must first deny yourself. Then pick up your cross and follow me." And to truly follow Christ, you need to become love. And see, this coincides together with denying yourself. And that's kind of crazy when you think about it. But love doesn't serve itself. So it says in 1 Corinthians 13, it says love is not self-serving. It says love is not prideful, it's not boastful. But mostly, it does not seek itself. So if it doesn't seek itself, then you cannot be selfish and be pure love. He said that we are to love, not only to love, but to become it. Jesus was it. And he still is it through us. People say, "Oh, it would be so much better in the world if Jesus would just come back and walk the earth." He's here. He lives inside of me. He lives inside of you. All you have to do is believe it. You get it? I say that for my wife. She loves it when I say that. Living righteously is not about what you do, but it's about what you believe. And so the next part of my scripture here is, as we fight to win. Wow, way off. Hold on. I'm going to get this back together. All right, we're on board now, right? All right. So, your eye, this verse 34, is the lamp that provides the light to your body. God wants to tweak your eye. He wants to tweak it just a little so that you see who you truly are and who you were created to be. You were created to be a child. You were created to walk in the glory of God. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son to restore us to the Father. So all you have to do is understand that and truly believe. I said this before in a sermon I did a while back. There's going to be no super Christians in heaven. I'm not going to see Pastor Jack flying around in the throne room with a big cape on that says SC on it. This cape, they're not going to say, well, he's got a bigger cape than me. No, it's going to be about who believed and who didn't. Who believed and who didn't. That's what it comes down to. How you see is how you be. So you see yourself as a child of God. You see yourself as a son or a daughter. You see yourself as redeemed, sanctified, loved. You will always feel that way because that's who you are. That's who you become because you believe it. Now, it says that the eye is the lamp of the body, but when your eye is healthy, the whole body is filled with light. So when your body is unhealthy, or when your eye is unhealthy, so that means you're seeing through a different lens. That lens is yourself. That lens of unhealthiness is yourself. So as you see through the lens of yourself, your body becomes filled with darkness. And the thing is that you might not even realize it. Because how many of you know that you could be doing ministry? You could be walking around, doing it on the worship team, you could be praising and worshiping. You could be feeding people out here that are hungry. And you could not know it. You can do all the ministry in the world and not know it. And not really know it. That's the biggest thing. Knowing Him is eternal love. Jesus lives inside of you. He loves you. All you have to do is understand that and believe it. And believe yourself. Believe it. Believe it about yourself. Because that's who you are. So it says, make sure that the light that you think is not, that what you think is the light is not actually darkness. Make sure that what you see is not through a lens of yourself. Make sure what you see is the truth, the narrow lens. So you tweak your eye to see the narrow lens of the truth. The truth will set you free. And Christ said, who the Son sets free is free indeed. So, what I say is that you have to fully die to yourself. You can't semi-live to yourself and semi-not. That's why it's so important in baptism. And you know, it's funny that a lot of times that the church gets wrapped up in debates about the biggest things. Baptism, catechism, all these other things that the church gets wrapped up in. And the fact of the matter is that Satan likes to counterfeit the biggest things in the church. Just like I wouldn't counterfeit $1 bills, I would counterfeit 100s. So just before you get into a debate with somebody theologically, and I tell you what, I spent a lot of time talking to the Lord here lately, and I've been watching some YouTube videos, and I see a lot of good preachers, a lot of good pastors out there that preach the word, but then I see a lot of good pastors out there that are very dogmatic, and what they do is they attack these other pastors for the way they're teaching. God let me know in my heart, He said, well, maybe they have a good intention, but they might not have said something right. So be careful about arguing with your brother. Don't let Satan try to destroy us. Don't be too quick to judge because we don't know the intentions of someone's heart. Let God judge them. So if they're really trying and they recognize Jesus Christ as Lord, then who cares about the rest of them? If they're becoming love and they're teaching identity in Christ and who you can be through Jesus Christ, and I don't know why I'm getting on this tangent right now, but it really had bothered me for a while about these pastors that had been attacking these other pastors, and I was kind of like thinking to myself, oh, well, they got a point, you know, but the fact of the matter is God said to me in my heart, he said they're just Sadducees. The Sadducees were members of the Sanhedrin. There were 71 members of the Sanhedrin, 35 were Pharisees, 35 were Sadducees, and the one high priest, right? So the Sadducees didn't believe in demons or angels or the prophets or anything like that, but the Pharisees did. They believed in the prophets, they believed in angels, they believed in all these different things. And God put in my heart that these people that judge and are attacking these other preachers for preaching the gospel that isn't contrary to what they teach, they're really just like the Sadducees and Pharisees, fighting back and forth on what they believe and what they don't believe. But the fact of the matter is that God told us to become love, to become like Him. We're not here to prosper. We are here to become changed. We are here to have a change inside of us. People try to, the only gospel I don't like preach is the gospel that is preaching prosperity instead of change. We need to change inside. We need to become love so that we can give it to others. So that we can share the love of God with others. It's the most important thing in the world. The most important thing you can do. If you don't know what your calling is in life, I'm telling you right now, your calling is to become love and be an example as a light to others. So all I'm asking you right now is to tweak the way that you see yourself. How you see is how you will be. Change the way that you see yourself. Change your perspective on your life. You can walk by that. It's not crazy to walk when you're all alone, walk into that mirror with a robe on, or with an invisible robe on, and say, Jesus, you look so good on me right now. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for making me righteous through your blood. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. You know why? Because that's a point of faith. That brings you closer to Him. Knowing that you put on that robe of righteousness every day. That's what brings you close to Him. Sitting there every day in your room, if you get a bad thought that comes into your mind, which we all do, let it go on through. It doesn't belong to you. That's Satan trying to get back in to where he doesn't belong. So what you do is you say, Father, thank you that I'm so far away from that. Thank you that I'm not that anymore. And this is how you become righteous. That's how you become righteous, because you believe it. You say, Father, thank you. Thank you that I don't have to be that anymore. Thank you that it's nowhere near me anymore. That's who I used to be, but I'm not that anymore. I'm a child of God, and I'm above reproach because Jesus lives inside of me. So if you don't have Jesus in your heart, and you want Him to come into your heart and to change who you are, and to show you the love that you deserve, because some of us, I know I needed affirmation from you and you and you to make myself feel worthy, but I don't need that anymore because Jesus loves me every single day. If any of you want to talk to one of our members of our church or groups or any of them, we'll be happy to pray with you and show you how to find Jesus in your heart. Show you how to believe and how you're supposed to receive Him in your heart and give it a place to land. I just want you guys to give it a place to land this love and this forgiveness that is already there for you. It's there. All you have to do is believe. I love you guys. This is all I got.
Thank you. Thank you both. I love the way you modeled that role of Jesus, you know? Give a little shimmy there. That was good. Hey, one thing, he really said, I hope you take this home. He said, what you believe makes a difference. Amen. We have an old saying, I went to seminary, some call it cemetery, but I went to seminary, and one thing they used to say there is good orthodoxy leads to good orthopraxy. Amen. What that means is what you believe leads to good practice. If you believe good things, it leads to good practice, good living. So when you start believing in the truth in Jesus, it leads to good living. When you start believing in the light, you'll start reflecting the light. Amen? All right. Well, hey, I'm going to thank the Lord for the food. I'm also going to pray for Gene. The Vittle van got vandalized. Someone tried to boost it. They tried to jack it, not knowing that it's got all the electronic chips and they weren't going to get it. All they did was jack it up. And so our Vittle van has become the Vittle sedan. We've got to get a new sign. Put it on it. Vittle sedan. But we're going to pray that they get that thing fixed. But we do have food for you, but you got to line up at the sedan tonight. So let's pray. Lord, we thank you. We thank you that you are the light. And when we put our trust and our hope in you, you help us experience you, but you also commission us to reflect your light and to share your good news. Lord, I just pray that we would all have a greater revelation of that in our hearts tonight. Lord, we thank you for the Vittle van, for Hope in the Streets. We just pray that they'd be able to get that van fixed easily. We pray the cost would not be great. And we ask your protection over that van, and whoever it is that's doing this crazy stuff, that you keep them at bay, that you keep them away. And Lord, we just pray you bless this ministry. And Lord, we thank you for this food that we have here tonight. We thank you for Bo. We thank you for Freedom Initiative. We ask your blessings on them. And Lord, we just say we love you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And they all say,
Amen.
Amen.